How did the human animal come to dominate all other life forms on the planet Earth? What's the secret of our unparalleled success? Could it have something to do with the way in which, during the course of our evolution, we radically changed our social behavior, becoming more cooperative as we faced daunting new challenges? In one important respect, we became unique among the primates. We became pack hunters. Indeed, hunting became a human obsession that went beyond mere feeding to become a whole new way of life. It was to transform us and make us, not the lion, the king of all the animals. For a million years, our ancestors were hunter-gatherers. Now all that has changed. Now we gather everything. We still eat meat, but we no longer have to hunt it down. Instead, we encounter it neatly cleaned and packaged as we forage among the urban branches of our supermarkets, plucking food from the shelves. Viewed as a pattern of human feeding behavior, a trip to the supermarket is the remarkable endpoint of a long journey through evolutionary time, a journey that started in a primeval forest and ended at a checkout counter. To me, it's a story of an arboreal ape, which became a ground-dwelling predator, which, in turn, became a credit card customer. It was working at the zoo back in the 1960s that gave me my unusual approach to the subject of human behavior. I'd started out my studies looking at fish, then birds, then mammals, and finally, chimpanzees. It was as though, without planning it, I was approaching the human animal by climbing up its family tree. This gave me a very different slant from people like psychologists or psychoanalysts, anthropologists or sociologists. To make my position clear, I gave the human species an animal name, the naked ape. And I set about describing our behavior in exactly the same way that I'd used when looking at all those other species in my earlier research. The more I studied chimpanzees, the more I realized just how intelligent they are. But despite their intelligence, wild chimpanzees have to spend most of their time feeding. This interminable food collecting is typical of animals that depend largely on a vegetable diet. Nutritionally inferior to meat, a great deal of vegetation has to be eaten every day for survival. In the primeval forests, this feeding process had been going on for millions of years, endlessly time-consuming and monotonously repetitive. And it's against this background that our own story begins. About 10 to 15 million years ago, the early apes from which we ourselves evolved must have looked rather like this. In this series, we've reconstructed and reanimated our earliest forebears as a reminder that humans did not in fact descend from chimpanzees, but from this common ancestor. It probably had a similar lifestyle to modern chimps, with fruits, berries, and nuts as its main source of food. And like them, it will occasionally have eaten a little animal food as a valuable addition to its diet. Although later this was to change, its original herbivorous lifestyle is one that's left its mark upon us even today. From our ancient primate ancestors, we've inherited a love of ripe fruits, berries and nuts, food which they found in the treetops and which we still consume today in 100 different forms. One of the key qualities of this kind of food is its sweet taste. And this has left us with a decidedly sweet tooth. In fact, we're so fond of sweet things that we will search for them everywhere, even at the risk of being stung by angry bees. In some tribal cultures, the craving for honey is so strong that the tastes of as many as 10 different types are distinguished by the expert honey seekers. And it's no accident that the very first alcoholic drink ever created by our species was mead, made, of course, from honey. Another continent, another insect. This type of ant collects honey in its abdomen, which becomes massively swollen and distended, making it easy to catch. For these native Australians, honey ants are a special delicacy, collected and savoured like small ripe fruits. Everywhere you look in the world, you find evidence of this human devotion to sweetness, inherited from our primate ancestors. And nowhere is it stronger than among our children, as a simple experiment will show. Here, sweet foods are on the left and non-sweet foods on the right. When children are allowed to take anything they want, they fall on the sweet foods and ignore the others. And it's not only children who react like this. It's worth asking why, if eating sweet things is so natural, it should often be viewed as unhealthy. The answer is that in nature, nutritional value and palatability go hand in hand. Whereas in modern life, any food can be made attractive simply by artificially sweetening it. It's intriguing that whenever we feel like a small snack between meals, we usually choose something sweet, as though in these casual moments, we're reverting to the primeval feeding behavior of the forest. The fruit-picking life in the treetops must have been comfortable and secure for our ancient ancestors. But then something happened. Perhaps there was a dramatic change in climate. Perhaps the forest suddenly shrank. We can't be sure. But whatever it was, it set our ancestors off in a search for a new habitat. They struck out into more open country, away from the trees, and began to explore this new environment. And as they did so, their diet began to change. The fruit-eating forest ape had to become a meat-eating plains ape. So the evolving human animal was to acquire a split personality, part herbivore and part carnivore. When our ancient ancestors turned to meat eating, they faced a daunting new challenge because now they were in direct competition with the well-established carnivores, animals with powerful bodies and strong jaws and teeth, animals like this. With our weaker jaws and smaller teeth, we had to find an alternative solution. We had to use brain instead of brawn. With our efficient hands, we began to make weapons, wooden spears, to kill our prey. In our early days, the simple act of accurate throwing must have been one of the most essential of all human skills. Precise aiming became nothing less than a matter of human survival. And we soon found that we were at our most efficient when we acted together as a hunting pack. Mutual aid on the hunt became another essential feature of our emerging species. The selfish, self-feeding herbivore had to become a helpful social carnivore. Old primate competition had to be tempered by new human cooperation. In this way, we were able to turn our attention to bigger and bigger prey, making our hunts increasingly efficient and giving us more and more spare time, during which our early technologies could develop and prosper. Our problems didn't end when the prey was finally caught and killed. The meat was too tough for our small jaws. Our answer was to attack it not with our teeth, but with sharp implements.
About 3 million years ago, we invented the flint knife to slice the meat up into chewable pieces. And then, with the discovery of fire, about 1 million years ago, we were at last able to enter the epoch of the human chef. We were able to prepare our meals instead of just bolting them down. We could cook and tenderize and savor the flavor by eating them hot, as if fresh from the kill. The hyena may have stronger jaws, but we had better techniques. Sliced and cooked, our meat became as easy to consume as a fruit or a berry. Instead of adapting our teeth to our food, we adapted the food to our teeth. The very idea of mealtimes is linked to our carnivorous lifestyle. Herbivores go munching monotonously on, hour after hour. But carnivores don't go for bulk, they go for quality. They only need to eat occasionally, and when they do, they binge. And they eat together. We humans, too, like to settle down to big meals together. Our mealtimes are social events. Significantly, on the rare occasions when our relatives, the chimpanzees, kill an animal and eat its flesh, their social behavior changes. Instead of feeding independently of one another, as they do when eating fruit, they feast together as a group and share out the spoils. Watching these scenes, it's easy to imagine the way in which our ancient ancestors began on their long road towards a carnivorous diet. When carnivores kill large prey, there's enough for all. This isn't altruistic, it's simply that there's so much to eat all at once. And for us, food sharing has become fundamental to our social way of life. When we take small, sweet snacks, we're happy to do so alone, at any time, anywhere. But when we feast on meat, we tend to gather together at a set time and at a set place. We sit down as a social group, like lions around a kill. The feast becomes a friendly event, binding us together as a group as we fill our bellies. Everywhere you look around the world, you find the same kind of human feeding patterns. The menu may vary, but the events are remarkably similar. So powerful is this carnivorous urge to share food that occasionally, when we do have to dine alone, we feel strangely uncomfortable. The solitary diner exudes the body language of unease. Eating sweets alone in public is pleasant enough, but eating a full meal alone in public is not. Ancient habits die hard. The social aspect of feeding is taken to an extreme at the typical cocktail party. Here, people drink when they're not thirsty and eat when they're not hungry. Significantly, most of the food objects on offer are savory or meaty rather than sweet. The food may only be a token, but it retains the carnivorous character that's in keeping with the sociability of the occasion. Here, the feeding behavior itself has become perfunctory. The social element of feasting has become so important that the feast itself is reduced to a mere accessory. When we evolved from fruit-picking primates into meat-eating carnivores, we gained the huge advantage of being able to consume almost any living thing. By varying our diet, we could spread out into almost every habitat on Earth. The Maasai of East Africa survive largely on a diet of blood and milk, both taken from their carefully tended cattle. When the cattle are bled but not killed, the blood is collected in long gourds. Milk is then mixed with the blood and stirred to coagulate it, producing a thick, sticky liquid. Some of it clings to the stirring sticks and is eaten almost as a solid food. This is a favorite treat for the young children of the tribe. The rest is poured into drinking vessels. The product of this process provides an extremely high-protein diet without any loss of livestock. Biologically, this could be described as a predator of cattle becoming parasitic on them, a highly efficient solution to life in this particular environment. We may find the idea of drinking blood in this way repulsive, but the Maasai undoubtedly feel the same way about some of our feeding habits. Every culture has its own food preferences and food taboos, developed over many years. These caterpillars are another valuable source of protein. Weight for weight, they contain more protein than a sirloin steak, even if they lack what one might call barbecue appeal. For these South Africans, they also provide important phosphates, minerals, and vitamins. In fact, insects are an ideal source of food, much favored by tribal peoples all over the world. Our modern preference for attacking insect pests with chemicals, rather than with our teeth, is highly irrational. Some cultures prefer to keep animals out of their diet altogether. The Toda tribespeople of southern India used to slaughter their domestic stock, but now refuse to eat meat on religious grounds. Here, they're consuming a mixture of rice, cane sugar, and salt, wrapped in edible leaves. But closer scrutiny reveals that they're also adding buffalo milk and honey to the mixture. Despite the poor nutritional value of their main staple foods, the regular addition of the milk and honey ensures that they remain fit and strong, a fact which they're proud to demonstrate with feats of strength. One of the strangest of all human feeding patterns is this, earth eating. Some clays, taken from special sources, are rich in essential minerals. In certain parts of Ghana, they're collected and molded into egg shapes. This is the ultimate exploitation of the environment, devouring the earth on which we stand. But these clays, when chemically analyzed, were revealed to contain calcium, magnesium, potassium, copper, zinc, and iron, remarkably similar to the mineral supplements recommended in Western society. The never-ending quest for food variety sometimes leads to danger. The Japanese delicacy called fugu, a kind of puffer fish, although much prized by gourmets, contains lethal toxins. If the toxic parts are not removed during gutting, they cause death within a few hours. 200 fugu diners die each year. Clearly, the human animal is the world's greatest omnivore, ready somewhere to eat almost anything. And for many people, it's not just a matter of eating anything, but eating everything. To see this in action, one need look no further than the table of a French family about to tuck into a celebratory dinner. Here, variety of edible life forms is the essence of the cuisine. To start with, cephalopods, in this case, squid. Then amphibians in the form of amputated frogs' legs. Then marine mollusks, some mussels. Then reptiles, as turtle soup. Then gastropods, the inevitable snails. Then crustaceans. More seafood, and echinoderms in the shape of sea urchins, followed by fish, birds, fermented fruit juice, mammals, with root vegetables, fungi, leaf vegetables, decomposing animal fat, and finally, fruits and nuts. Given sufficient affluence, we demonstrate with great panache the omnivory that has made us great as a species. The engines are on. 4, 3, 2. No matter where we go now, we can solve the food problem. Even in outer space, we can find a way to nourish our bodies. We've come a long way from the forest trees of our remote ancestors, and our passionately varied diets have taken us into every corner of the globe and beyond. But how did we start this amazing journey? What were the formative stages that were to take us soaring up and away from our animal relatives, leaving them gibbering in the branches while we conquered the skies? Perhaps re-examining our evolutionary roots will help us to understand.
This is where the human story began, millions of years ago, in the heart of Africa. But how it began remains something of a mystery. There's a gap in the fossil record when we can only guess what was going on. The gap in our knowledge lasts from roughly 4 million to 7 million years ago. We know that apes went into it and ape men came out of it, but that's all we do know. Oh, and the ape men, of course, when they came out, we know what happened to them. There aren't any missing links in the popular sense. We can trace our ancestry back for over 3 million years, and we can see how those ape men turned into modern men. But back in that very early formative stage, that's when the picture becomes vague. Why did we shed our coat of fur, stand up on our hind legs, and start to talk?
To understand why this took place, we need to discover where it took place.
Perhaps it all happened here on the open savannah. The traditional view, and it's only a guess, is that our ancient ancestors left the cover of the forest and moved out onto the open plains in pursuit of large prey animals.
Once in open country, they had to face a hot, dry, exposed environment. How did they adapt to it? Other animals that live in hot, dry environments have evolved special survival mechanisms that reduce their water loss. Surprisingly, we have none of these. We have to drink more than any other land mammal. We sweat more than any other mammal. And we die quickly if we overheat. We have dilute urine and moist dung. These five qualities contrast strongly with the water economy of the typical savanna-living animals. The truth is that we're simply not well adapted to savanna living. So what did we do when we left the protection of the undergrowth? The traditional view of how ape became ape man has recently been challenged.
It's thought that there might have been a vital intermediate stage. Instead of coming out of the forest and straight onto the open grasslands, the idea is that our remote ancestors went instead to the water's edge. There they went more and more into the water, becoming what you might almost call an aquatic ape.
Newborn babies, under careful supervision, can swim without any training. Placed in a prone position in warm water, they show no panic, keep their eyes wide open, and automatically hold their breath. Champion breath holders can hold their breath for up to 3.5 minutes underwater. This and the swimming ability of the newborn are, to say the least, strange qualities for a savanna-living animal. There are a number of other aquatic features of our species. We have an unusually strong diving reflex that slows down our heartbeat when we put our face underwater. Like other aquatic mammals, but no other primates, we have a layer of blubber beneath our skin. We've lost the long, shaggy coat of other primates, making us more streamlined in the water. We have a unique nose shape that shields our nostrils when we dive below the surface. We have more flexible spines than other apes, enabling us to swim more rapidly. We have partial webbing between our fingers and toes, again, unlike any other primate. We weep copious tears, like other marine animals, but unlike apes. We can swim with great athleticism. Apes cannot swim at all. And the directions of our hair tracts differ from those of other apes, following the flow of the water. Assembled in this way, the evidence for the aquatic origin of our species certainly looks impressive.
If this human baptism took place, it probably occurred here on the estuaries of the East African coast. One of the effects of moving into the water for these aquatic apes would have been to find immediately a wonderfully nutritious source of food, a new kind of food, a change from the fruits of the forest to the fruits de mer.
These small boys in Kenya's Rift Valley are behaving rather like otters, catching fish without the aid of any weapons. They're living today in the very region where the human species evolved. Could this have been the preferred way of life of our early ancestors several million years ago? A switch to an aquatic lifestyle would suddenly have made available a high-protein diet that would have reduced the amount of time they had to spend finding food. This would have given them more opportunities for other activities, activities that could have led them to develop important new skills. Their ancient ability to open tough nuts and fruits would have made them immediately adept at cracking open the hard shells of a great deal of easily collected seafood. Marine mollusks and crustaceans would have had no protection from the attacks of this new type of predator. They were a plentiful food supply just waiting to be exploited. Furthermore, a diet of fish and shellfish would have provided the aquatic apes with an enriched source of the fatty acids that are important for brain development. An aquatic ape could easily have become a more brainy ape. These are the amazing Muru Army divers of the Philippines. Each member of a large team of young male divers lowers a rock attached to a long line down to the seabed. Strips of white material scare the fish, and as the lines are moved along with their rocks repeatedly banging on the reefs below, they drive all the fish before them into an enormous net. Once all the fish are in the net, the young divers descend without any breathing apparatus to a depth of 80 feet, where they may stay for up to 3 minutes. In the earliest days of the human story, cooperative fishing could easily have been the first step on the road towards efficient pack hunting and our eventual role as successful land predators. The aquatic ape theory of human origins remains unproven because we still lack the fossil evidence to support it. But whether we pass through an aquatic phase or not, one thing is certain. Our ancestors did eventually move onto the savannah and start to hunt down large prey animals. This was to become our new way of life that was to sustain us for over a million years, right up to the agricultural revolution a mere 10,000 years ago. And even today, in a few remote areas, the primeval hunt continues. These are caribou, roaming the desolate lands of the far north of Canada. For native Canadians, these deer are an essential source of food. For them, caribou hunting is a matter of survival. When the dog rib people set off on the chase, the outcome may make the difference between starvation and plenty. The moment of departure is full of happy anticipation, anticipation of feasting to come. The hunt goes through its characteristic stages. There's the long journey to the hunting grounds, then the initial search for the herd. The first sighting of them in the far distance is reassuring, but they're in open country where they can't be approached. Next, there's the planning of the strategy to be adopted. Now, there's more group cooperation as the tactics of the assault are put into action.
That's what I did the other day.
The hunt will be extremely physically demanding. Weapons, as ever, are crucial to the success of the chase. The women who accompany the hunt do not take an active part in the kill. While the men are stalking the herd, they search for berries in this desolate place, following in the ancient footsteps of the primeval food gatherers. Like wolves encircling their prey, the hunters move in close in wooded territory for a clean kill.
It's your day.
But unlike wolves, their communication is complex and their strategy sophisticated. As with all carnivorous hunters, good long-distance vision is crucial to their success. Their weapons may be modern, but the hunting pattern these men are following is a million years old. On this particular hunt, it took a week to make the kill. And by this time, the group had been almost without food for 3 days. In the bitter cold of the northern landscape, starvation had been staring them in the face. After the kill, the carcass is cut up and prepared, ready to be carried back to the community. The intense relief that is felt when the feast finally comes is something that's difficult to appreciate for those who've never experienced this ancient, uncertain form of human food-seeking. It's easy to understand why, 10,000 years ago, we started to give up this way of life and turned instead to the security and the predictability of farming, of controlling the wild animals and making certain that they were always around to provide us with guaranteed regular meals. But it has to be admitted, there was something bravely hazardous about the hunt. With the advent of agriculture, the drama of the chase was lost. Only the dog rib and a few other remote hunting societies remain now to remind us of the earlier way of life. For most of us today, the rigors of the hunt, its uncertainties and dangers, are a thing of the past. Nowadays, all we have to face is a trip to the local supermarket. So what happened to our inborn hunting urges? Where did they go in the modern world? The primeval act of setting off on a hunt has acquired a new name. Now we call it going to work. Modern hunters leave their home base not on a chase for large prey animals, but in pursuit of contracts, deals, and sales. They'll make a killing in the city and bring home the bacon without ever setting eyes on wild game. Each occupation has its own special kind of substitute hunting elements. For some, it's the comradeship of fellow hunters. For a few, there remains the frisson of actual physical danger. This was a key element in the original hunt, but with modern substitute hunts, it's now comparatively rare. For some individuals, though, this danger element is crucial. They need the adrenaline boost that accompanied every dangerous hunting trip. For most, the risks have now become purely financial. These are the typical hunters of modern times, who've retained the strategies and tactics, the planning and the plotting of the old hunting lifestyle, but in a completely transformed state. For some, the pseudo-hunt is a stalking, prowling affair, with the emphasis on the symbolic kill at the end. The average traffic warden has the immense satisfaction of making many kills every day, with, from time to time, the added excitement of a little spirited but futile resistance from a squirming prey.
Oh, you've already got a ticket.
You know, we deliver the meat. I could just meet inside and come.
Yes, you know, it is a clearway.
You know, we have a business here. We have
but it's a
delivered
clearway.
Meat.
I'm
what can I do?
Yeah, but have you left me to see you eat your
head? I have to put you in the fridge and freezer and come back.
Yeah, but you never said you were
in the fridge. Oh, that's not. I look
around. Well, I'm sorry, you've got tickets.
Each to their own kind of hunt, each to their own type of chase, and each to their own form of kill. The modern pseudo-hunters are everywhere. At the end of the hunt, when the worker returns home, the spoils of the chase inside the pay packet are handed over.
Northbound, northbound.
Those who are most engrossed in their work and find it particularly satisfying are the ones whose activities contain most of the old hunting elements. For them, the symbolic hunt retains almost all its original excitement. For some, the symbolism is very obvious, with a specific and visible prey to be pursued. A police chase brings out all the old hunting skills.
Say the driver, he's running straight southbound down the alley. Gene just cut back to the west between the houses. Okay, got him crossing the fence here, coming across the street in front of the officer, still westbound. Officer's getting right up on him now. They're taking him down.
Almost all the elements are still there. The strategies and the tactics, the cooperation and organization, the concentration and the risk, the arduous pursuit, and finally, the climax of the kill.
Let's go after him.
Fine, let's do it.
A few people seem unable to make the symbolic leap away from the primeval hunt to one of its modern substitutes. Trapped in the past, they feel the urge to continue needlessly to gun down wild animals for sport. These hunters are not starving, and their prey are not dangerous. The animals have been specially reared on game ranches so that they can be shot at by sporting gentlemen who don't wish to suffer any undue discomfort in the process.
Thank you.
That's a long shot.
I'm glad I put two shells in there. I was thinking about only putting one.
That's a good shot.
Killing these animals with high-powered weapons is about as courageous as shooting at a cow in a field. But sport hunting, which has been going on ever since the primeval hunt became obsolete, still manages to survive. So deeply ingrained is the predatory past of our species.
Turn it down and turn him towards you a little bit that way. Let me get that full curl. There you go. Let me try that.
For most people today, however, the idea of killing animals for fun is repugnant. Instead, when their hunting urges drive them on to track down a wild beast and take a shot at it, the loudest noise you hear is the click of a camera. These shots are all on target, but no blood is spilled. And the excitement of taking home the pictures of these animals provides a symbolic trophy more in keeping with the modern environment in which these symbolic hunters live today. All over the world, the symbolic hunters are out stalking their prey. And because they are symbolic, the prey can take some rather odd forms. As collectors, people seem prepared to hunt down and carry home almost anything, sometimes at enormous cost. For some collectors, simply finding the prey is sufficient reward. For these train spotters, the prey animal becomes the giant locomotive that glides into their sights, giving them the hunter's thrill of discovery. Like real prey, each railway engine is beyond their control. Only by being in the right place at the right moment can they add another exciting specimen to their list of symbolic kills. They can't eat these trains, but they can at least feast their eyes upon them. Wherever today's pseudo-hunters gather in small groups, there's a strong chance that some kind of symbolic prey will be struck down. The nature of the prey can be reduced to the simplest possible form. In this case, a wooden skittle. It's virtually impossible to simplify the symbolic hunt further than this, but the excitement is still there. The human animal can make a hunt out of almost anything and celebrate accordingly. For many people, the workplace is sadly lacking in the more exciting elements of the substitute hunt. For them, special events outside the working context are necessary to recreate the drama of the chase. The solution for many millions is professional sport. Here on the football field, almost all the stages of the primeval hunt are displayed for the spectators. There are the team tactics, the group cooperation, the long-distance communication, the physical risks, the skills, the stamina and the bravery, the stalking, the cunning and the chase. And at last, there's the moment of the kill as the tribal weapon is driven into the mouth of the prey. This act of aiming is common to most forms of modern sport. With victory in sport, as with victory in the hunt, there follows a triumphant celebration, a moment of euphoria shared by all. Sometimes the intensity of the moment becomes too great. The passions of the primeval hunter have been so aroused that the symbolism is lost and the violence of the hunt itself is once again unleashed. When a human being becomes the new prey and the hunting pack turns on one of its own kind, the savagery of the mob knows no bounds. For the lynch mob, the victim becomes effectively a member of another species, a prey to be destroyed. This is not normal human aggression. This is a corrupted hunting pack on the prowl, looking for a kill. In this case, the victim was rescued. Those who argue, through wishful thinking, that the human animal is essentially placid and docile are making a dangerous error. They need look no further than the seemingly innocent games of children to see the way the human mind works. We're hunters through and through, always chasing something, always in pursuit of some goal, whether abstract or real. This human quality, this urge to meet a challenge, to take a risk, to track down a solution, is one of our greatest attributes. To say that man is a hunter is not to say that man must be violent. Far from it. All it says is that he's not docile. We're by nature go-getters, but what we get is up to us.
Gotcha!
All too often, the games of childhood become corrupted into the war games of adult life. Instead of using our hunting urges to chase wonderful ideals, we use them to pursue a new kind of prey, human prey. The hunting urge is a double-edged sword. It can be used constructively to help us fulfill our greatest dreams, or destructively to live out our greatest nightmares.
ich weiß, das kann nicht anders sein. Denn ihr seid Fleisch.
When the hunt became symbolic, it retained its power but lost its direction. It's now up to us, to our intelligence, not our instincts, to determine that direction. And it's a dark day whenever we fail. In modern warfare, the combination of the ancient hunting urge and modern technology has been deadly. Because the new weapons act at a greater and greater distance, the enemy is no longer an identifiable rival human being, but a tiny speck in the distance. There's no personal involvement. The enemy soldiers are not people, they're prey. If only hunting hadn't made us such a cooperative species, it would be impossible for tyrants to form armies and set them off on campaigns of mass destruction. Warfare is the darkest face of the human urge to hunt. This all seems light years away from the quiet life we left behind in the primeval forests, when we gave up the simple fruit-picking existence and set ourselves the challenge of a new way of obtaining our food by using tools and weapons. We could never have guessed that far off in the future, we'd be giving ourselves the possibility of both a technological heaven and a technological hell on Earth. Which of these two comes to dominate our lives in the future remains the greatest of all human dilemmas. And it's amazing to think that this whole story all began with a small change in our diet millions of years ago.
One thing is certain. When our ancient ancestors had passed through the early phase of their evolution and had become fully-fledged hunters, their social way of life had to change. When the males went off on the hunt, they had to have somewhere to come back to with the spoils. They had to have a home base, a fixed home base. That meant settlements and dwellings. And the way in which those early dwellings grew and flourished and developed into our modern megacities is the subject of next week's programme.